This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Lost on the Orinoco or American Boys in Venezuela. Author: Edward Stratemeyer. Year: 1902. Preface: Lost on the Orinoco is a complete tale in itself, but forms the first volume of the Pan-American series, a line of books intended to embrace sightseeing and adventures in different portions of the three Americas, especially such portions as lie outside of the United States. The writing of this series has been in the author's mind for several years, for it seemed to him that here were many fields but little known and yet well worthy the attention of young people, and especially young men who in business matters may have to look beyond our own states for their opportunities. The Great Pan-American Exhibition at Buffalo, NY, did much to open the eyes of many regarding Central and South America, but this exposition, large as it was, did not tell a hundredth part of the story. As one gentleman having a Venezuelan exhibit there expressed it, "To show up Venezuela properly, we should have to bring half of the republic here. And what is true of Venezuela is true of all the other countries." In this story are related the sightseeing and adventures of five wide-awake American lads who visit Venezuela in company with their academy professor, a teacher who had in former years been a great traveler and hunter. The party sail from New York to La Guayra, visit Caracas, the capital, Macuto, the fashionable seaside resort, and other points of interest nearby, then journey westward to the Gulf of Maracaibo and the immense lake of the same name, and at last find themselves on the waters of the mighty Orinoco, the second largest stream in South America, a body of water which maintains a width of 3 miles at a distance of over 600 miles from the ocean. Coffee and cocoa plantations are visited, as well as the wonderful gold and silver mines and the great llanos or prairies, and the boys find time hanging anything but heavy on their hands. Occasionally they get into a difficulty of more or less importance, but in the end all goes well. In the preparation of the historical portions of this book, the very latest American, British, and Spanish authorities have been consulted. Concerning the coffee, mining, and other industries, most of the information has come from those directly interested in these branches. This being so, it is hoped that the work will be found accurate and reliable as well as interesting. Once more thanking the thousands who have read my previous books for the interest they have shown, I place this volume in their hands, trusting it will fulfill their every expectation. Edward Stratemeyer. April 1, 1902. Chapter 1: The Boys Talk It Over. Hurrah, Mark, it's settled at last. What is settled, Frank? We are to go to Venezuela and other places in South America. My father just got the word from Professor Strong. I brought the letter along for you to read. That's certainly immense news, remarked Mark Robertson, as he took the letter which Frank Newton held out to him. Does he say how soon he will be able to start? Just as soon as he can settle up affairs at Lakeview Academy. I suppose he's got quite something to do there yet. But we can hurry him along, can't we? I don't think you'll hurry the professor much, answered Mark, as he began to read the communication which had been passed to him. He's one of the kind that is slow but sure, not but that he can move quick enough when you least expect it. As for instance, on the night we tried to hide all the schoolbooks in the old boathouse, responded Frank, with a twinkle in his eye. He caught us neatly, didn't he? That's what. Hello. So Beans and Derry are going too. I like that first rate. Beans is all right, even if he is from Boston, and Derry will furnish fun enough for a minstrel show. To be sure. I wouldn't want to go if they weren't along, and you. But do you see what the professor says, on the last page? He wants to take Jake the Glum along too. At this the face of Mark Robinson fell somewhat. I wish he had left Glummy out, he said. He knows the fellow is sour to the last degree, and a bully in the bargain. I guess the professor wants to reform him, Mark. He'll have uphill work doing it. Glummy has been at the academy 2 years, and I know him pretty thoroughly. Well, he'll be the richest boy in the crowd. Perhaps that had something to do with taking him along. No, the professor doesn't think so much of money as that. Each person in the crowd will have to pay his share of the expenses and his share of the professor's salary, and that's all, outside of the incidentals. I wonder if the incidentals won't be rather high. I fancy we can make them as high as we please, buying souvenirs and things like that. You can be sure Glummy will try his best to cut a wide swath if he gets the chance. Perhaps the professor will hold him in. But it's great news, isn't it? And in his enthusiasm, Frank began to dance an impromptu jig on the library floor. Frank Newton was a New York City youth, 16 years of age, tall, well-built, and rather good-looking. He was the only son of a Wall Street banker, and if his parent was not a millionaire, he was exceedingly well-to-do. The lad resided in the fashionable part of Madison Avenue when at home, which was not often, for his family were fond of going abroad, and either took the boy with them or sent him to boarding school. Directly opposite the home of the Newtons lived the Robertson family, consisting of Mr. and Mrs. Robertson, Mark, and several smaller children. Mr. Robertson was a dry goods importer who owned an interest in several mills in England and Scotland, and he made trips across the Atlantic semi-yearly. Although Mark Robertson was a year older than Frank Newton, the two lads were warm friends and had gone to school together for years. Their earlier education had been had in the city, but when Frank was 11 and Mark 12, both had been packed off to Lakeview Academy, a small but well-conducted school nestling among the hills of New Hampshire. 5 years of life at the academy had made the place seem like a second home to the boys. The master, Professor Amos Strong, was a thorough gentleman and scholar, and under his guidance the boys progressed rapidly in all their studies. The professor had in his day been both a traveler and hunter, and the stories he was wont to relate during off hours were fascinating to the last degree. As might be expected, the boys, while at school, made many friends and also an enemy or two, although as regards the latter, the enmity was never very deep, for Professor Strong would not tolerate anything underhanded or sneakish. Next to Mark, Frank's dearest chum at the academy was Dartworth Crane, a slightly built boy of 15 who was as full of fun as a boy can well be. Dartworth, or Derry, as he was always called for short, was the son of a rich Chicago cattle dealer, and the boy's earlier days had been spent on a ranch in Montana. He loved to race on horseback and hunt and fish, and the master sometimes had all he could do to hold the sunny but impetuous lad within proper bounds. As Frank had another chum, so did Mark in the person of Samuel Winthrop, the son of a well-to-do widow who resided in the Back Bay district of Boston. Samuel was a tall, studious-looking individual, with a high forehead and a thick mass of curly black hair. Because he came from Boston, he had been nicknamed Beans, and although he did not relish the sobriquet, it was likely to stick to him for years to come. Among the lads to join those at the academy 2 years before had been Jacob Hockley, a thin, lank youth of Mark's age, with a white freckled face and hair strongly inclined to be red. Hockley was the only son and heir of a millionaire lumber dealer of Pennsylvania. His manner was peculiar, at times exceedingly bossy, as the others declared, and then again morose and sour, the latter mood having won for him the nickname of Glummy, or Jake the Glum. Hockley was given to spending his money, of which he had more than was good for him, freely, but even this had failed to make him any substantial friends. The enmity between Hockley on one side and Frank and Mark on the other had arisen over the captaincy of the academy baseball team the summer previous. Jake wished to be the captain of the team, and had done his best to persuade or buy the boys over to vote for him. But Frank had advocated Mark for the captaincy, and Mark had won, much to the lank youth's discomfiture. "You'll never win a game with Mark Robertson as captain and with Frank Newton on first base," had been Jake's sour comment, but he was sadly mistaken. That summer the team played 9 games with the teams from rival schools, and won 7 of the contests. The winning made Jake Hockley more down on Mark and Frank than ever, but as the others were popular, he had often to conceal his real feelings. On a windy night in June, the cry of fire had aroused every inmate of Lakeview Academy from his bed, and had caused all to leave the rambling building in a hurry. The conflagration had started in the laundry, and from this room quickly communicated to the kitchen, dining hall, and then the remainder of the stone and wood structure. In such a high wind, the fire department from the village, 2 miles away, could do little or nothing, and the efforts of the students, headed by the several teachers, were likewise of no avail. Inside of 3 hours, everything was swept away, and only a cellar full of blackened debris marked the spot where the picturesque academy had once stood. Under such circumstances, many a man would have been too stunned to act immediately, but ere the stones of the building were cold, Professor Strong was laying his plans with the insurance companies for the erection of a new and better structure. The students were cared for at some neighboring houses, and then refitted with clothing and sent home. During the fall, there had been much talk of a personally conducted tour to South America during the coming year, the tour to be under the guidance of Professor Strong, who had been south a number of times before. Letters had been sent to the parents of various students, but nothing definite had been done up to the time the fire occurred. Mark and Frank had planned for the trip south and could not bear to think of giving it up, and as soon as Professor Strong was in a position to give them his attention, Frank had gotten his father to write concerning it. Several letters passed, and at last Professor Strong decided to leave the building and the management of the new academy to his brother, who had just left the faculty of Harvard, and go with the boys. While the trip was being talked of at the academy, previous to the fire, Jake Hockley had announced his determination to go, but since the boys had separated, nothing more had been heard from the lank youth, and Mark and Frank were hoping he had given the plan up. The announcement, therefore, that he would make one of the party, put a damper on their enthusiasm. "He'll get us into some kind of trouble before we get back, you see if he doesn't," was Frank's comment. "I'll make him keep his distance," was Mark's reply. "If he attempts to go too far, I'll show him that I won't stand any nonsense." The party of six were to leave for Venezuela by way of New York City, and a few days after the conversation just recorded, Sam Winthrop came down on the train from Boston to remain with Mark until the arrival of the professor. "Beans, by all that's delightful," cried Mark as he wrung his friend's hand. "So glad you came a few days ahead." "I wanted a chance to look around New York," answered Sam Winthrop. "I've never had a chance before, you know." "You shall look around all you please, and Frank and I will go with you." "Is Derry here yet?" "No, but Frank expects him tomorrow. Then we can all go around until Professor Strong arrives. But say, what do you think about Glummy going?" And Mark looked anxious. "Can't say that I am overjoyed, Mark. I wish it was anybody but Hockley, and Frank wishes the same. Well, all arrangements have been made, so we'll have to make the best of it. But I heard one thing that doesn't please me," went on Sam. "I got a letter from Dick Mason, and in it, he said Glummy was talking of the trip to some of his chums, and said he was going just to show Frank and you a thing or two." "Did he? I wonder what he meant." "He didn't mean anything very good, you can be sure of that, Mark." "You are right. We'll certainly have to keep our eyes open and watch him," concluded Mark, seriously. Chapter 2: Preparing for the Start. On the following morning, Derry Crane came in, on the limited express direct from Chicago. He sent a telegram ahead to Frank, who went up to the Grand Central Depot to meet his chum. "Had a fine trip," said Derry, "but honest, I couldn't get here fast enough, I've been that anxious to see you. Heard from Beans yet? I'll wager he comes down with his grip loaded with beans, on account of the long trip, you know." "What, didn't bring any beans? Must be a mistake about that." "I guess he was afraid you'd forget the pork," answered Frank with a laugh. "But how have you been since you left school?"
"First class. Went west, you know, with my father, and nearly rode a pony to death on the Lone Star Ranch. Oh, it was glorious to get over the ground. Beats a stuffy old city all to bits. Hold on, I've got to look after my trunk. Wouldn't want to lose that, for it's got the whole outfit for the trip in it.
Our man will have the trunk brought to our house, answered Frank. You come with me and I'll take you down to Mark's, where you'll find beans.
By the way, heard anything of Glummy?
Did I?
Well, I just guess, Frank.
What do you think?
He actually paid me a visit, not very long of course, but still he came to see me. Said he was passing through Chicago on a trip to St. Louis, and felt that he had to hunt up an old chum.
I almost fainted when he said it.
But he acted quite decent, I must admit, not a bit airish or sour either.
Did he say anything about this trip to South America?
Not much, excepting that he would like to go if it went through.
I didn't say much either, for I was thinking you and Mark wouldn't like to have him along.
You don't, do you?
Not much, although I guess we can stand it if he lets us alone.
We needn't have much to do with him.
Taking Derry's valise from him, Frank led the way to the street and hailed a passing auto cab, and both were speedily taken to the home on Madison Avenue. A few minutes later, they hurried across the way and joined Mark and Sam. In anticipation of the good times ahead, all four of the lads were in a happy frame of mind, and the remainder of the day was spent by the New Yorkers in showing the visitors around Central Park and other points of interest. In the afternoon, the four went downtown and crossed the Brooklyn Bridge. Then they came back to the Battery and took the little craft which plies hourly between that point and Bedloe's Island, where is located the Statue of Liberty, standing as a gigantic sentinel to New York Bay.
How big it looks when one is close to it, remarked Sam, when they disembarked close to the base of the statue.
I thought climbing to the top would be easy, but I fancy it's going to be as tedious as climbing to the top of Bunker Hill Monument.
And so it proved, as they went up the dark and narrow circular steps leading to the crown of the statue. They wished to go up into the torch, but the way was blocked owing to repairs.
Suddenly Mark, on looking around him, uttered an exclamation of surprise.
Glummy Hockley! How did you get here?
His words caused the others to forget their sightseeing for the moment, and they faced about, to find themselves confronted by the freckled-faced youth who had been gazing in the opposite direction.
I'll thank you not to call me Glummy, said Hockley coolly, although he too was taken by surprise.
Then he turned to Derry.
How do you do, Derry?
When did you arrive?
Mark bit his lip and looked at Frank, who gave him a knowing look in return.
Clearly, it had been an ill beginning to the conversation.
Somehow Mark felt as if he had not done just right.
Excuse me, Glum, I mean Hockley, I'll try to remember your proper name after this, he stammered.
I don't mind those things at school, but you must remember we are not at school now, went on Hockley, with something of an air of importance.
Then he smiled faintly at Sam.
How are you, Beans?
Excuse me, but we are not at school now, and my name's not Beans, was the dry response.
There was a second of silence, and then Derry burst into a roar of laughter, and Frank and Mark were compelled to follow, the whole thing seemed so comical.
Hockley grew red, but when Sam joined in the merriment, he felt compelled to smile himself, although he looked more sour than ever directly afterward.
All right, Sam, I'll try to remember, he said with an effort and held out his hand.
The two shook hands, and then the lank youth shook hands with Derry.
After this, there was nothing to do but for Frank and Mark to take Hockley's hand also, and this they did, although stiffly.
But the ice was broken, and soon all were talking as a crowd of boys usually do.
Hockley had brought a field glass with him and insisted on all using it.
Bought it down in Maiden Lane this morning, he remarked.
Got the address of a first-class firm from a friend who knows all about such things. It cost me $65, but I reckon it's worth it. Ain't many better glasses around. I expect it will be just the thing in Venezuela.
No doubt, said Derry, but felt somewhat disgusted over Hockley's air of importance.
Nevertheless, the glass was a fine one, and everybody enjoyed looking through it. Ships coming up the lower bay could be seen at a long distance, and they could also see over Brooklyn and Long Island, and over Jersey City and Newark to the Orange Mountains.
"What are you fellows going to do tonight?" questioned Hockley, when they were going down the stairs again.
"We thought something of going to Manhattan Beach to see the fireworks," began Frank, and broke off short.
"I was thinking of going to Coney Island," went on the lank youth. "Supposing we all go there? I'll foot the bill."
"I shouldn't care to go to Coney Island, and I don't think Derry and Sam will care either," said Mark.
"Let us all go to Manhattan," broke in Sam. "I've often heard of the fireworks." He had not the heart to give Hockley too much of a cold shoulder. So it was arranged, on the way back to the Battery, and then there was nothing to do but ask the lank youth to dine with them.
"We are bound to have Glummy on us, sooner or later," whispered Mark to Frank while they were eating.
"Perhaps it's just as well to make the best of it. It will be time enough to turn on him when he does something which is openly offensive." When it came time to settle the bill, the lank youth wished to pay for everybody, but the others would not allow this.
"Let everybody pay for himself," said Derry.
"Then there won't be any trouble."
"I can pay as well as not," said Hockley sourly.
"So can any of us," returned Mark dryly, and there the subject dropped. The trip to Manhattan Beach and the fireworks were very enjoyable, and before the evening came to an end, everybody was in a much better humor, although both Mark and Frank felt that they would have enjoyed the trip more had Hockley not been present. Hockley was stopping at the Astor House, and left them near the entrance to the Brooklyn Bridge. He had wanted them to have a late supper with him, and had even mentioned wine, but all had declined, stating they were tired and wished to go to bed.
"He must be getting to be a regular high flyer if he uses much wine," remarked Frank, when the four were on their way uptown.
"What a fool he is with his money! He thinks that covers everything."
"He'll be foolish to take to drink," returned Derry. "It has ruined many a rich young fellow, and he ought to know it."
"I think Hockley would be all right if it wasn't for the high opinion he has of himself," came from Sam.
"But his patronizing way of talking is what irritates. He considers nobody as important as himself. In one way, I think he'd be better off if he was poor.
The family haven't been rich very long, only 8 or 10 years, so I've heard," said Mark.
"Poor Hockley isn't used to it yet. It will be a lesson to him to learn that there are lots of other rich folks in this world who aren't making any fuss and feathers about it."
In the morning came a message from Professor Strong, stating that he had arrived and was stopping at the Hotel Manhattan. He added that he would see Mr. Robertson and Mr. Newton that morning, and would be at the service of the boys directly after lunch.
"Now we won't lose much more time," cried Frank.
"I declare, I wish we were to sail for Venezuela today."
"I fancy the professor has a good many arrangements to make," said Sam.
"It's quite a trip we are contemplating, remember?"
"Pooh, it's not such a trip to Caracas," returned Derry.
"My father was down there once, looking at a coffee plantation."
"A trip to Caracas wouldn't be so much, Derry," said Mark.
"But you must remember that we are going further, to the Great Lake of Maracaibo, and then around to the mouth of the Orinoco, and hundreds of miles up that immense stream. They tell me that the upper end of the Orinoco is as yet practically unexplored."
"Hurrah, we'll become the young explorers," cried Derry enthusiastically.
"Say, I wonder if the professor will want us to go armed."
"I don't think so," said Frank.
"He'll go armed, and as he is a crack shot, I guess that will do for the lot of us."
"Glummy showed me a pearl-handled pistol he had just bought," put in Sam. "He said it cost him $16.
"He'd be sure to mention the price," said Frank with a sickly grin.
"I'd like to see him face some wild beast. I'll wager he'd drop his pistol and run for his life."
"Maybe somebody else would run too," came from Mark.
"I don't believe it's much fun to stand up in front of a big wild animal."
"Are there any such in Venezuela?"
"I don't know, we'll have to ask the professor."
Chapter 3 On Board the Steamer. When the boys presented themselves at Professor Strong's room at the Hotel Manhattan, they found that worthy man looking over a number of purchases he had made while on his trip downtown.
"Glad to see you, boys," he said as he shook one and another by the hand. "I trust you are all feeling well."
"Haven't been sick a minute this summer," answered Derry, and the others said about the same.
"I see you have your firearms with you," remarked Mark, as he gazed at a rifle and a double-barreled shotgun standing in a corner.
"We were wondering if we were to go armed."
"I shouldn't feel at home without my guns," returned the professor with a smile.
"You see, that comes from being a confirmed old hunter.
I don't anticipate any use for them, except when I go hunting.
As for your going armed, I have already arranged with your parents about that.
I shall take a shotgun for each, also a pistol, for use when we are in the wilds of the Upper Orinoco."
"Will you lead us on a regular hunt?" asked Derry eagerly.
"I will if you'll promise to behave and not get into unnecessary difficulties."
"We'll promise," came from all.
"I have been making a number of purchases," continued Professor Strong.
"But I must make a number more, and if you wish, you can go along and help me make the selections."
Is Jake Hockley coming up here?"
Question mark.
"I expected him to come with you.
Isn't he stopping with one of you?"
"No, he's stopping at the Astor House," came from Frank.
There was an awkward pause, which was very suggestive, and the professor noted it.
With his gun in hand, he faced the four.
"I'm afraid you do not care much to have Master Hockley along," he said slowly.
"Oh, I reckon we can get along," answered Derry, after the others had failed to speak.
"It is unfortunate that you are not all the best of friends. But Hockley asked me about the trip a long while ago, and when it came to the point, I could not see how I could refuse him. Besides that, I was thinking that perhaps the trip would do him good. I trust you will treat him fairly."
"Of course we'll do that," said Mark slowly.
"I guess there won't be any trouble," said Frank, but deep in his heart he feared otherwise.
"Hockley has not had the benefits of much traveling," continued the professor.
"And traveling broadens the mind. The trip will do us all good."
They were soon on their way to 14th Street, and then Broadway, and at several stores the professor purchased the articles he had put down on his list. The boys all helped to carry these back to the hotel. On arriving, they found Jake Hockley sitting in the reception room awaiting them. The face of the lank youth fell when he saw that they had been out on a tour without him.
"I'd been up earlier if you had sent me word," he said to the professor.
"I suppose I've got to get a lot of things myself, haven't I?"
"You have your clothing, haven't you?
I mean the list I sent to you."
"Yes, sir."
"Then you are all right, for I have the other things." From the professor, the boys learned that the steamer for La Guayra, the nearest seaport to Caracas, the capital of Venezuela, would sail 3 days later.
"There is a sailing every 10 days," said Professor Strong.
"The steamers are not as large as those which cross the Atlantic, but they are almost as comfortable, and I have seen to it that we shall have the best of the staterooms. The trip will take just a week, unless we encounter a severe storm which drives us back."
"I don't want to meet a storm," said Hockley.
"Afraid of getting seasick," came from Frank.
"Not exactly," snapped the lank youth.
"Perhaps you'll get seasick yourself."
"Does this steamer belong to the only line running to Venezuela?" asked Sam.
"This is the only regular passenger line. There are other lines, carrying all sorts of freight, which run at irregular intervals, and then there are sailing vessels which often stop there in going up or down the coast."
The 3 days to follow passed swiftly, for at the last moment the professor and the boys found plenty of things to do. On the day when the steamer was to sail, Sam's mother came down from Boston to see her son off, and the parents of Mark and Frank were also on hand, so that there was quite a family gathering. The baggage was already aboard, a trunk and a traveling case for each, as well as a leather bag for the guns and ammunition. At last came the familiar cry, "All ashore, that's going," and the last farewells were said. A few minutes later, the gangplank was withdrawn and the lines unloosened. As the big steamer began to move, something like a lump arose in Frank's throat.
"We're off," he whispered to Mark.
"Guess it's going to be a long time
before we get back." Mark did not answer, for he was busy waving his handkerchief to his folks. Frank turned to Sam and saw that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.